Good evening, and welcome to tonight's Sliver Lecture, part of the Spring Series Architecture at the Gloves Lecture. It's my great pleasure to introduce Louise Lemoine and Emma Fetka, two filmmakers whose fascinating series, Living Architectures, gave us the confidence early on that the decision to invite a wider circle of people in cultural fields adjacent to architecture was the right one. Tonight, they will be screening selected scenes from the films, and afterwards we hope to have a 15-minute question and answer session with these filmmakers. So please jot down anything that piques your interest during the filming, because we'd like to have a discussion after the screening. Ms. Lemoine and Mr. Becca make films about architecture, which is to say that they use film as a precise tool to probe how buildings and people interact. By doing so, I feel they reveal something critical about how architecture tends to operate in film. Mostly, I think architecture operates as a kind of substrate that's a backdrop for character-driven narratives. But I think that while buildings may influence, constrain, and color the action in typical films, they rarely do themselves become explicit characters or receive roles which threaten to upstage actors. One notable and often mentioned exception occurs in Jean-Luc Godard's 1963 film, Contempt. This movie stars, in addition to Brigitte Bardot, Jack Palance, and Michel Piccoli, a rather stunning and sun-drenched villa that goes by the name of Malaparte. This house was perhaps destined for film greatness thanks to its dramatic site on the Isle of Capri, and also its quirky and intensely personal design, which was conceived not so much by an architect, but more by a writer who had his way with the initial sketches of a more traditional architect. However unlikely it is that the curves of any building would ever outshine those of Brigitte Bardot, this happens in Contempt. Casa Malaparte becomes a spectacular, scene-stealing member of an already remarkable ensemble cast of human actors. In the 60s, it was perhaps rare that a modern building could seduce audiences so easily. Now I think we find that it's routine, and this is no accident. Contemporary architects, such as Wim Kuhlhaus, have turned the tables by taking cues directly from cinema. Striving to unfold film's mesmerizing theatricality and delectable voyeurism directly into architecture. By adopting filmic strategies and related techniques, he and many other auteur architects, which I think is better than his architect, regularly produce buildings that provocatively recalibrate the relationship between architecture and its occupants. It is precisely this new breed of contemporary building that is dissected by Ms. Lemoine and Mr. Becker, I would say. They do this with neither reverence nor malice for scene-stealing architecture, but rather with sharp eyes and ears for the ways in which people and buildings interact. They are keen social observers. They conduct probing, yet intimate interviews that yield a trove of unauthorized accounts of how buildings really operate in the minds and in the lives of the people that inhabit them. They also have a beautiful spatial sensibility, which I think we'll see tonight. Their films often capture incredibly beautiful kinesthetic delight of bodies moving through space in novel and unexpected ways. Their ability to make a connection between the most technical features of the building and the emotional lives of its inhabitants is nothing short of remarkable. The critic Nikolai Orsov, who's a visitor to this school, has called them cult figures of the European architecture. Their first film, Kuhlhaus House Life, which you'll be seeing some excerpts from tonight, garnered great reviews after its presentation at the 2008 Venice Biennale. And they have subsequently completed six more films in the Living Architecture series, including Gary's Vertigo, Exodus Meyer, and Inside Piano, among others. Their films have been presented internationally in many cultural institutions, such as the New York MoMA, the Centre Pompidou, the Palais de Tokyo, the Canadian Centre for Architecture in Montreal, the Netherlands Architecture Institute in Rotterdam, and many, many others. We feel very fortunate tonight that we are also able to host a screening and a discussion of scenes from Living Architectures. Please help me in giving a very warm welcome to this moment, Louise Lively and Rebecca. So it would be great if everyone could stick around for questions.
How do you choose the buildings? Is it like a critique on which you can start?
just wanted to have some different buildings on different scale. So we have a house, a church. So we need just to film people in different spaces. So just to get help. We work on the icons. Some very busy, because in a sense, and then those architects too. Because we don't want to explain the architecture. So, if, for example, Guggenheim Museum, everybody knows a lot of pictures, everything, see all the pictures you want. So this gives some freedom to film something else. But,
we chose a certain typology of architecture, which is linked to their mediatic presentation, their presence, and they are all maybe about 10 years old, more or less, and that's a point very interesting for us because we didn't want to work on the very recent architecture. We wanted also to introduce some thematics about aging, about the body of architecture. So it's all, we needed some architecture that had at least some years of usage. And inside the work of these articles, we've chosen building that had a certain typology of use. And for instance, the Herzogenburg building, which is not so much known, but had a very interesting use for us and for the type of shooting we were interested in, because it's a kind of, it's about a building that most of the year is not used, and for 15 days in the year, it has a kind of crazy activity around the grape picking. And so we follow these 15 days of grape picking, and it's in each building, as you understood, we are getting the point of view of the users, so our visit to the building is thanks to what's happening there. So more activity there is in the building, more it's easy for us to be introduced.
Did the architects see your movie?
Yeah. Like we have not the extra of the film sheet or the interviews with the architects, but it's an interesting part of the work, because we first make the films and then we propose the films to the architects. The first viewer, and we made an interview with him. So we've done all the interviews and catch maybe their first reaction to the films, because they were not all prepared before, they didn't send the film before. For instance, maybe some of you may have seen the interview made with Rolf Bolas, which is in the DVD extra of the film. And all of them are we're very interested by their reaction, because most of them accept that all these films bring to them what they cannot know about the buildings. What, once they have left the building after the completion, they do not know what's happening in the building, and they have very few occasion to go back and to know how it is used, how it is maintained, how it is it lively or not. And we had an interesting talk with Renzo Piano on this issue, and he considers his building a bit like his children, and so he's very aware of which means they grow well or badly, and so he is very interested to see how it's going on today.
because you showed a clip from the Kohlhaas offside. And one of the reasons why I didn't choose that example in my introduction is because it was designed as like basically a piece of the stage that was like designed for the movie, whereas Casa Malaparte was sort of more of a serious piece of architecture. But obviously the Kohlhaas house is beginning to kind of be, have a self-awareness that maybe architecture in the past didn't have. And I think that all of the buildings have a self-consciousness that maybe pushes them more towards active characters than kind of buildings beyond or before that era happened. And I'm wondering if that's, I don't know, if you think it's true or not true, or is architecture in general getting more more strident, more outgoing? Is it competing, or is it relating to people in a different way than before?
It's an interesting question. You mean in terms of if they are aware, if the building could be aware of their identity or visual identity?
Well, maybe in a way, just the kind of formal language of architecture has gotten quite exuberant, I would say, in the case of like Gary. And in the case of, let's say, a contrasting example like the villa by Kohlhaas, there's a different kind of attitude that is also very present, let's say. There's not an idea that the building should be discreet, but that it's very, very present at all times. And I'm wondering if that's something that I don't think really makes your work possible, or what's motivating your work.
Yeah, but it's this question links also to the question of aging, because we've made this film 10 years after we started, and we see all the problems of maintaining the building in its initial shape or identity. And so it's interesting how much buildings maybe today are focusing on the present more than on its perennity. I don't know if the word is correct in English, or it do not maybe protect so much in the long future. And for this, for instance, having worked on in various buildings, maybe Arezzo Piano has the most developed this conscious of projecting his building in the future, because they are extremely well, they work extremely well, and even 30 years after. And,
the reference of Tapi, or not, is more linked to the scientific part of the film, not really for the, yeah, for sure, that's a link for the modern architecture. What we like about our person, we like that he is just the ironic way of looking at architecture. So we are very attached to Tati because he has a very, very precise way to look at things about the body and the human body and the spaces. But with eyes, with a lot of eyes, I think that's for me the best way to show something without explaining. So that's what we try to do. It's like the chapter of the lady going down of the lady step. We say nothing, we just watch. But you understand that, you understand there's a big problem with this. The problem is the part of architecture, but yeah, therefore I have to. She was very tired. But you know, I don't explain nothing. Normally in the architectural film, the directors or the authors, they explain everything. They explain it. So maybe I think that the director is for that.
Thank you.
translate it to a kind of democratic impulse, because when I saw your movie in 2018, Biennale Venice, you have a kind of feeling that now you show these buildings that it's like a kind of upper class architectural discourse of the people who know what Kohlhaas' ideas were about, including lots of architecture. And then you have this green lady, and she sees the house more as a nuisance, because also in the clip that we saw today, she was just walking around, they don't really know what she's checking on, but seemingly she has a plan, but she'll never find out what the plan is. She's checking on the bed, what is wrong. I mean, not taking the cataract episode, which I think is more a baroque thing. But is there a kind of impulse that you would say there is people that have to live with this architecture, and they are just not the audience that the architect was targeting, and they don't get it, and they can't get it, because their approach to architecture is the one of the servants and not the one of the masters for whom this architecture was built. So it's that, because everything seems to be pretty critical socially in terms of who understands what and who is meant to understand what.
Yeah, that's a good point. We were extremely, through all these series of films, we mainly focused, we have chosen the focus of the word issues inside these buildings, mainly for many reasons. We were very interested to put in, to reveal how much this architecture needs care on a daily basis. It's a fundamental aspect of its growing and well aging. And so we were extremely impressed by how much care it needs and how much inventivity it needs daily. So that's why we have chosen to visit these buildings through the eyes of the person that are dealing with maintenance. We also want to underline in this film series that architecture is a kind of, the way we wanted to show it, it's a kind of a phenomenon that a building that has a kind of impact, and the secondary effects can be on very, very different levels. And more than portraying architecture itself as an object or as an extraordinary structure, we really wanted to document all these secondary effects it can have. And it has a lot of effects on ordinary life of people that's living, working, and need to be in a constant relationship to these buildings. And I think, of course, you can have the historical discourse about architecture, the critical discourse about architecture, but also what we wanted to point out here is that architecture, as it has so much effect on the daily life of everyone, it can also be treated through a very ordinary level of discourse. And so we really wanted to give voice to the forgotten figures of architecture, of the invisible person who daily maintenance of architecture.
Yeah, that's something else that very interesting to speaking with the people that are being buildings. Normally they are like let's say intellectually nervous. So because they don't know really nothing about the building or the world. And you are very interesting about speaking with the world, what the people say. When you make interview with the owner, someone that the build is not his interest. So he can say something really real. So just about the sensation of living inside the building. I think in such a famous building is this. We find just these people that can speak like that. The other, I don't know, we try to speak with other people in this building, but nothing comes out. It's just, we wanted to find the free word, you know, the free speaking, because we know, we try to. Guadalupe in the Colas Alta, she has, I think, that's my opinion, she has a really chance to say anything she wants. No? There's no censor, there's nothing. And this was a very great, an enormous chance we had to speak freely. There's nothing happened. In architecture, film, in architecture, actually, the world is too much controlled. It's controlled by the public relations, controlled by the architects, it's controlled by everyone. And the only little chance we have is to pass through the people who they are not interested in architecture.
You take the vision of someone who's as Reiner said, not in possession of another man. He's not the one for whom it was primarily conceived. So that's the vision of someone who's rather at the margin.
The margin is interesting, the margin, because it's really, I think. It's a beautiful image, but I think that the last land of freedom of speaking is the margin, I think. Everything is controlled. Not maybe a little bit less the margin, so we go there.
Actually, initially, before
the
screening, we introduced the film series in saying that desire was to reintroduce into the film what everything that had been left apart from the main representation and imagery in architecture. And as Ina said, the speech was extremely controlled, and also the main focus of architecture image today is mainly promotion. We can have a debate about this, but most of the images that circulate in the media are made to also promote the architecture, in the sense that either because of the origin of the commission, the film or the picture, is linked either by media or the architect itself. So the freedom took in this film series is by not having any commissioner, neither the architect, neither TV, neither any type of media. And so that's why also we wanted to go further in this freedom to reverse also the habits of talking about these kind of buildings.
I was not taking this, I think this is very interesting about this, look at what the minorities. I was just thinking, or asking myself, is how specific can you be by choosing this group to establish your discourse with the architecture? Because I would see a kind of gradual difference of meaningfulness, at least what I saw in the various films, because the window cleaning in Gary, I think, is too much a stereotype that has been used very often in saying that architecture is like not very pragmatic and not very useful. Whereas the endlessness of the woman walking in the villa in Bodo, I I think it was interesting because you ask yourself, what is she thinking? The other one was a kind of plain problem that comes up ever so often. I would say almost every architect who does something that is specific would be confronted with how do I clean the windows.
Actually, it's, to me, it's a difficult exercise in the sense that of these films that are all lasting 1 hour, you are looking just at a few minutes of the film. So with the glass cleaners, actually, we made a long interview to the film. What we liked very much about doing then is that it's not only actually the cleaning aspect or the maintenance aspect, it's a kind of first layer of our intent. It's not, we're not just focusing on how a building is maintained. It's we are very interested to see how much there was a kind of a clash of scale between the building and the techniques that were used to maintain it, for instance, because all of these films are made around the idea of a relationship between a building and a body. And for instance, in the few excerpts you saw, you can see how it's the absurdity of the scale clash between the 30 meters high of this space and a little, I don't know the word in English, a little chiffon, something to clean. The huge beam, which is just a piece of a fabric, and it's amazing how much these are very practical issues, but they are very much part also of how it works, and so through little details like that, we can also reveal some bigger issues. That's why we chose that.
On a less critical note, I guess, like instead of thinking about how there is a emotional connection between how these people operate in this building versus how you view the building, would you say that you, in your process, developed a kind of an emotional connection to these buildings? And if so, in what way?
Because before we arrive in this building, we're arriving in this building, we try to put apart our, let's say, aesthetical judgment on the architecture. It's not our point just to make a film on the building we like or we don't like. It's not this we're looking for. But our judgment over the building can completely evolve and change and be modified through the experience we have inside during the shooting. And for instance, the original Maya project in Rome was a full experience of changing mind over the days, because we spent there about 10 days during Christmas. And through the inhabitants' testimonies, discussions, views through their various apartments, and also through the priest's point of view, which is, as you saw, very different from the inhabitants' point of view. We were in a full immersion of how it is to live in this area that has been completely modified by the presence of this church, because you know that this neighborhood of Rome is very outside the city. Thank you.
have an opinion about these buildings to begin with, no? So which one is your favorite building?
I think it's very important to say that we don't have an opinion. Maybe we have, but it's just it's really not important because if you try to understand what two people are speaking about, you don't know. You have to don't know what you don't have to track the difference of the priori or something. We try to go to make films in a building, to be very, if we can, ignorant, to be very dirty, to say. So we try to not have an opinion. We don't want to have an opinion. We just want to go there, see, watch, listen, speaking with people, and if people don't like, they like. It's a documentary way of seeing what's going on. So
I think it's, as I said before, it's that our judgment of the building evolves hugely through what the concrete, the real situation of life gives us back, in the sense that knowing architecture through publication is something, knowing the building through the daily life and going there and spending time there with people that are dealing with it every day, make you change your mind completely, I think. And we appreciated very much the details of the building that we couldn't even have thought before, just looking at this project through a book or a publication. And so that's how we, that's a bit our psychological condition when we arrive.
If you continue doing this type of films, what kind of interest do you have for the next who would you choose for the next architect, for the next series of films about architecture? What would be your interest? Like you say, you mentioned these films deal with how the building gets older. Maybe you can take buildings and see how the building, it's like a kid, you know? He just get born, and how is he reacting to the new situations and to the new environment? And so,
actually, a curious situation, because we made all these films in auto production. It was a long and difficult way for us to make these films, because as I said, the team had no permission, so it's we've decided to make them on our own. But today, thanks to these films, some architects are coming to us and asked to film of this type on their building. And so it's a kind of strange curve. But we are also, this series is finished for us, and we want to evolve in the way of looking at architecture. We just planned the project through animation, design animation, and in a very animated way, but also through fiction. We move a bit from this kind of documentary aesthetic to a bit more perhaps in fiction. For instance, we have a project with Tatiana Bilbao in Mexico.
All the
to use a humorous language, so focusing on the shortages of the architectural projects, I think just chose a pessimistic way of presentation. Did you, the question is, are you trying to be a kind of railroad or just to show the peacocks oddly like?
Yes, I didn't understand. You mean that our intention is only to see the critical aspects, the negative points?
Kind of.
Why you say that?
Yeah, we have this strong reputation, but it's not true, actually. As I said before, we started with the Colas House Light film, and we conceived it as a laboratory.
Thank you very much.